Hi, I'm Andrew Greenberg. I'm the faculty advisor of the Portland State Aerospace Society, and I have a sort of what happened over the last year in Portland State Aerospace Society. And I know that a lot of our alumni will be watching this, and I know that a lot of people who have no idea what we're doing will be watching this, so I'll give a little bit of an intro and hit what's happened to us over the last year, which is actually pretty interesting. And I don't think we've ever given a what's happened to us in the last year lecture, so this will be also new for us. I'm a senior instructor here at Portland State University, and the Portland State Aerospace Society is a bunch of students. A bunch of students in all walks of life. So we have some favorite words in Portland State Aerospace Society, or PSAS. Interdisciplinary is our favorite word. And that's because we've got mechanical, electrical, computer science, and business, and math, and physics, and local high school students, and people from community college, local community colleges, and industry advisors, people in industry around us who come and help out. And it's really, it's an awesome community, and we're open to everybody. The idea is that we have an open source interdisciplinary space program that people can come and participate in. And we've got four major projects, we'll talk about it. But I thought it would be a kind of fun to review why we even exist. Oh, and by the way, secretly, besides building my own private space program with undergraduate free labor, really the real reason PSAS exists is because, of course, hands-on interdisciplinary teamwork is what makes industry go. And so this is actually making much better engineers I'd be proud to hire in my companies, by giving them direct experience, which is great. So we have a hilarious vision statement. And I want to emphasize vision, not goal. We're never going to do this. Our vision is that we want to build a rocket to put our own 1 kilogram nanosatellite into orbit. And this is kind of fun because, you know, kilogram is about a Coke can, so we want to put a Coke can into orbit. And it turns out we could put a Coke can to, you know, we could get it up kind of high. Like, it's not so hard to get high. You can go up 10 kilometers. You can go above airplanes. We might even be able to get up to 100 kilometers, way up to 100 kilometers, which is the edge of space. But whatever we put up will just fall right back down, because most of the energy and the hard part of getting something into orbit is going around the planet at 17,000 miles per hour, 8,000 meters per second. Stupidly hard, stupidly a lot of energy. Those rockets are so big because by the time you get your Coke can to orbit, that Coke can could take out a city block. It's about 100 kilograms of TNT worth of energy in that Coke can. So this is something that we will never do. We would need millions of dollars. We're open to millions of dollars of donations. We'd need tons of lawyers. We would need a huge program. We would need a facility. We're not going to do it. But what if we tried anyway? What if we built the technologies, did the technology demonstration? What would we learn in the process? And would this be a really good exercise for undergraduates? Which is, the answer is yes. So we have four major projects. Number one is launch vehicles. Second is liquid fuel engines for those launch vehicles. Third is CubeSats. And the fourth is ground stations. So I'm just going to go through them, kind of give you the updates over the last couple, over the last year. I was going to say a couple of months, but it's been a year. So we've got a long history of launch vehicles here at Portland State Aerospace Society. We've been flying them since 1998, which is hilarious. And our last one was 2018, which is actually a really, really long time ago. The last one we flew tore itself apart in flight. It was our first carbon fiber airframe. Carbon fiber did amazingly well, but the module interfaces, the aluminum module interfaces between the carbon fiber failed because of aeroelastic bending. Super interesting, and I won't get into it, but that was a long time ago. We should be flying more rockets more often. And so finally, we're almost ready to fly our next one in April of 2024. We'll go out to the eastern Oregon desert outside of Bend, Oregon, and we'll fly LV 3.1, launch vehicle 3.1 after 3.0 teared itself apart. And 3.1 has some interesting stuff. It's actually got a really weird recovery system. Most recovery systems for amateur rockets have just two parachutes. They have a drogue parachute that opens up at apogee, lets the rocket drop really, really fast, and then a big main parachute comes out and lets it go very gently to the ground. We're adding a third component, which is way up here, the very top of the rocket, and that's called a balute. And that's, let's see if I can get this to actually work. Yes, excellent. So this is going down 4th Avenue here at Portland State University in one of the undergraduate capstone last year's car. And that is a balut. It is a balloon parachute. And basically what happens is it's a high Mach number parachute that we can open up when we're way above the atmosphere and just fall straight through until we hit the lower atmosphere and start decelerating. And so the idea is it's a stable way of getting down to the lower atmosphere without something tearing itself apart. So we're going to test that. Do we need that for LV3.1? No, we're only going to about, I think it's even 6 kilometers. So we don't need it, but we'll be testing that as part of a technology demonstration. The other thing we're doing, which is weird for an amateur rocket, is we're getting away from pyrotechnics and we're moving to something called, we call the electromechanical recovery system. That is literally an electromechanical system that keeps two of our modules together. Yep, we have a little video of that going on right here. That was kind of hilarious. This is the 3D printed version. We have a full version now. And you can see the little shoes going in and out. Those little shoes press out and keep the two modules together. And as always, it's an interdisciplinary system. So not only do the mechanical engineers make the little system that grabs pushes the shoes out and grabs the two modules together, but there's an electrical engineer working on the print circuit board to run the system and a firmware engineer doing programming. So all of that is to get us from LV3.1 to LV4, which is the next generation rocket. And we've actually been doing quite a bit of work on the next generation rocket. Last year we had a mechanical engineering capstone that made the first parts of our LV4. It's a much larger rocket. Instead of 6 inches in diameter, it's 12 inches in diameter. And this is part of the new system that we're moving toward. We're actually moving away from carbon fiber because carbon fiber, it turns out, is ridiculously lightweight and an amazing thing to work with if you're a multi-million dollar company with molds and a giant oven and freezers and all the things that you would need to do carbon fiber right. It turns out if you're a small undergraduate program, carbon fiber is not great. The students who work on it graduate and then no one knows how to work on it, and then the material goes bad after a few years and become toxic waste, and there's splinters and blah, blah, blah. And it turns out that we don't do carbon fiber well enough to justify it compared to something that NASA did in the 60s called IsoGrid. So we can do IsoGrid way better than we can do carbon fiber. And so we're moving towards that as a technology. And that's one of the cool things about this project is we're not afraid to say, oh yeah, we tried that, that wasn't great, let's do this. And so there's a lot of this technology demonstration, there's a lot of this prototyping back and forth, a lot of rapid prototyping, a lot of failure, which is kind of cool. That's how it works in the real world, right? So this is a quick test that we did. This is an IsoGrid module and we're crushing it right now. You can see it's starting to deform down here. And yep, and there you go, in just a second, it'll just crush. And that, I forgot, that was like 10,000 pounds of pressure or something like that. I don't remember. And this IsoGrid system is something that we can do all day long on a very cheap CNC router with a 4th axis. So that's great. We can do that. We can build rockets from that. This year, we've made, for the first time, some pretty amazing progress on our liquid fuel engines. We have a huge test stand that we've built that we've been working on for years and years and years, which is an amazing test stand. But it's really complicated, and by the time students get to work on it, they graduate. So we realized we needed downscale. We needed a minimal test stand, something that we could just put in the back of a Subaru Forester, because it's Portland, and drive out to the local forest and fire. And so we put a capstone together to do the minimal test stand. You can see them here. We did our first hot fire of a liquid fuel engine this June. They went from January to June and knocked it out of the park. And now we have a test stand that we can fire multiple times per year and test small scale engines. It's only 100 Newtons, but it trains the next generations of engineers such that by the time they're juniors and seniors, they'll be ready for the larger scale test stand. Also, at one point, we should learn to take good movies because we've got a lot of garbage movies of this thing firing. But here you can see the engine that the students built, just a 100 Newton engine, and the nitrogen tank. You can't see it back here, but there's two small tanks for isopropyl alcohol and liquid oxygen. And then this is a prototype nozzle right there. And now, by the way, thank you to Lindy, who allowed us to test fire at their plant right next to the liquid oxygen generator, which was cool. A lot of you know we also do CubeSats, working on the 1 kilogram nanosatellite that we'll finally put in space. Orsat Zero is successfully still in orbit. It's not transmitting right now for reasons, but they're all the right reasons. We had it working in the first 2 weeks and then 8 months later, and we may have it working again in the future, but at this point we're putting on hold because we've got other satellites coming down the pike. Right now it's gone from 525 kilometers down to 475 kilometers, so we've dropped about 50 kilometers in the last year and a half. We expect to be in orbit for another 2 to 3 years, and then that will burn up again as Oregon's first meteor shower. So that's exciting. We had real working space hardware, extremely excited about that. And now we're sweating blood and tears about the next generation satellite called Orsat 0.5. It's called 0.5 because we had Orsat 1, then we built Orsat 0, and then we got another opportunity to fly, so we had to put it between 0 and 1, right? So Orsat 0.5 is handing off in just 44 days in December, early December, and then flies on Transporter 10 in February of 2024. We are extremely excited about it. It has a lot of stuff on it. It is a much more complicated satellite than Orsat 0. It has an attitude determination control system, which is what we're trying to test. That's the whole reason for this flight, is to make this work for our final mission, Orsat 1. And we're also trying a prototype of the Cirrus Flux camera, which is a shortwave infrared sensor that will help us identify cirrus clouds, high-altitude cirrus clouds from space. So those are the two. And we also have a deployable S-band antenna. We have a STEM outreach for the state of Oregon that we're flying on Orsat 1 as well. And this is a technology demonstrator for that as well. So Orsat 0.5 is really, can we build a real satellite? Can it really work? Can we point it and do some of the subsystems work? Orsat 1 is probably a 2025 deploy from the International Space Station. Yes, we keep pushing it back. And that's got all the missions on it. And I won't go over the missions. You can go to oresat.org to read about the missions for Orsat 1, including the Cirrus Flux Camera climate science mission and the Orsat Live STEM outreach mission. We've added a couple things to the system since we last talked. We had a senior capstone that put together the coolest thing ever. You all probably know about what we call FlatSat. That's where we take the satellite, we lay it down on a table, and it's just a flat satellite where we can probe and program and do all the kinds of things. Well, to make that FlatSat hardware in the loop testing actually accurate, we wanted to be able to run the solar cells, the solar modules, as if it were in space. So this is a halogen bulb. You can't see it on the underside, but you can see the blue glow here of UV LEDs and blue LEDs, and those are underneath this. And each of these pretends like it's the sun, and there's a solar module on each thing. So usually we should have four, but we only have three working right now, and they'll turn on and off as our environmental simulator tells us which side of the satellite is pointed to the sun in the simulator. So the simulator, we tell what's our tumble rate, and then it runs these as if we're going behind the Earth or if we're in the sun, that kind of thing. So that's really exciting because that's a real hardware-in-the-loop testing of the entire system. Our Cirrus Flux camera is running on the NASA ER-2. It's a modified U-2 spy plane that NASA runs. In the back of these little pods, we are actually trying out. Thank you to University of Maryland, Baltimore County, that's flying it for us. It's really exciting. We 2 years ago, we were on the HASP mission, High Altitude Student Payload, for a NASA balloon. And now we're on the U-2 spy plane, which is pretty cool. One of the really interesting parts about our group, by the way, is our ability to just say, no, you know what? That's not working. Let's change. And we're not afraid of it. And just like carbon fiber to IsoGrid, we also went from a highly capable, adorable little STM32 microcontroller, which was totally the right job for running the satellite, it's all we needed, to a full-on Linux installation running the entire satellite. And the reason for this transition is because this is too hard for undergraduates. And what I mean by that is, it's not too hard. We can certainly have people program it, but then you have to learn a real-time operating system. And then you have to learn the CCSDS Universal Space Packet Protocol. And then you have to learn about how we do USLP. And then you have to learn about the CAN bus and CAN open. And then you have to, so by the time you've learned all this, you've graduated, right? It literally takes years. And so we realize what we really need is the ability to write very easy Python scripts and then distribute them among processes so that individual students can work on individual processes. And so thus we move from this 32-bit microcontroller running in RTOS to a full Linux installation running Python 3. And in about the last 3 months, we've made more progress on our software than we have in almost a year with the microcontroller. So again, it was a weird, not a great hardware choice for the satellite, but a great technology choice for us as a program. And again, since everything is open source, hopefully other university groups as well. Our final project, we've always been a big fan of satellite network operational ground, satellite networked open ground station, or SatNOGS. SatNOGS is a Hackaday Prize from 2014. They are now, I believe, one of the world's largest ground stations. Amateurs, anyone really builds ground stations. Each of these green dots is just someone deciding to build a SatNOG station and put it in their backyard. And there are literally hundreds of them around the world. And when ORSAT Zero was in space, all of the data that we got back from our beacons came from SatNOGS. And SatNOGS has its own open source receiver that you can build. We built a really simple one on top of the engineering building just to add to the network because we were so grateful to SatNOGS. And so SatNOGS is this amazing thing. Problem is it's receive only. And we need the ability to talk to our satellite. So we built on top of SatNOGS a new project called the University Class Open Ground System. And the Open Ground Station, excuse me. And that's currently on the engineering building roof here at Portland State University. Again, it's open source, so there are other universities, hopefully Cal Poly Pomona, hopefully University College London, hopefully UMBC will be building their own versions of Uniclogs. And now, for the first time, we can network around the world and have transmission stations as well. Thank you so much to the Amateur Radio Digital Corporation, or ARDC. We got a giant grant from them this summer, and that allowed us to hire some interns for the first time for ourselves. And now we're working on Uniclogs version 2. And this is a much more flexible, much more sophisticated, and still just as cheap, about $10,000 to $10,000 to $20,000, depending on what you build, a station. For the new enclosure, a 2.4 meter dish, and we even got the mechanical engineers involved and got them to do some CFD, so we knew that we had enough weight on the bottom of the non-penetrative mount so that the thing wouldn't fall over in a windstorm. So we're very excited about Uniclogs V2. That will not only do 2.4 gigahertz, it'll also go up to 10 gigahertz, which is X-band, and that's gonna be great because the future is X-band. Also, we're taking over the Small Business Administration because they have a building and we're putting our ground station on it. Last but not least, this has been a year of the students getting out there. There have been a billion outreaches. We've been to the Beaverton City Library. We were at the Oregon Museum of Science and Industry, OMSI Science Festival. We were at two or three amateur radio talks. We've been all over the place talking about ORSAT, talking about this project, and doing STEM outreach, which has been really fun. Finally, we've been to several conferences, Oregon Space Grant Consortium and the SmallSat Conference in Logan, Utah. We're finally getting out there. People are learning about us, and it's been very exciting. People already know about us, right? If you're a university group working on a satellite, you've probably heard of us, which is kind of exciting to know. Even though we think all of our designs are garbage and need a version 5, and you should help us build version 5, at the same time, it's at least an open source reference design that's out there. It's been really helpful. So congratulations to the students for an amazing year of hard work, and look forward to 2024 of another launch, test fires, a new ground station, and another satellite in space. Thanks for coming. I'll turn it back to Aiden.
Thank you. Thank you, Andrew. That's a great talk. We do have a question from online, and they're asking if extreme cold has been considered in the design of presumably ORSAT and future ORSATs, and if so, how?
Yes, is the answer. So when you build a satellite, a low Earth orbit satellite in particular, radiation is not that huge of a problem. It's a problem, but not a huge problem. It's only when you start getting out in the Van Allen belts or you go out to Jupiter or something like that, that it's a real problem. So the biggest problem for us is thermal, right? So when we go behind the Earth in the Earth's shadow, the temperature plummets. And when we're in the sun, one side of the spacecraft is at like 100 degrees C and the other is at like minus 10 degrees C, right? So there's this huge differential. And so we are hopeful that the satellite tumbles in space. And when we control which way it points, we'll do something called the barbecue rule, where we actually spin the satellite at a slow pace to distribute the sun's energy and warmth. And so what happens is that you try and distribute all of that heat energy into your satellite for the time that you go behind the Earth, and then you cool down. We do a thermal simulation. I could bring it up, but that would take too long. And the Thermal Desktop is the name of the company. Thank you, Thermal Desktop. That shows us that we'll be at about minus 10 degrees C for the upcoming mission. Turns out our first mission, ORSAT Zero, was a balmy 19 degrees C, which is like 65 degrees. We call it the T-shirt orbit. And that's because we never went behind the Earth's shadow. But because the next one will be going in the sun synchronous orbit behind the Earth's shadow, we will have an average temperature of about minus 10 degrees C. That's a real problem, right? We have to use components that can absolutely go down there. And it turns out automotive grade components, the chips and the capacitors and the resistors and all the things built for automotive, are perfect for that orbit because they're made for minus 40 degrees C all the way up to about 80 degrees C, even sometimes 100 degrees C. And so that's the perfect thing for a satellite. So we use those components. And for our batteries, which can't stand to go below 0 degrees C, we have a heater on board. And I can't get into it because it's going to take too long, but we have a relatively sophisticated thermal system on board ORSAT to couple all the circuit boards together as one mass and separate the batteries so that the batteries are their own little thermal unit and we can heat those without heating the rest of the satellite. So there's other stuff going on too, but yeah, it's thermal rating is a huge deal.
Awesome. Thank you very much. I believe that's all the questions we have for today.